Why do I appear to be so, you know, serious and grim? Well, because I'm really stupid. That's a tough one to handle. In fact, I just, the path is realizing your stupidity, actually. Incredible stupidity. And, there's no question about it. Especially the idea that the stupider you are, the greater that greater you are. That's a really powerful one too. So in the path is the mood of repentance. I said, wow, how stupid, amazing. I'll tell you what the world really is. The world is, but the purpose of the world is to prevent us from realizing it has no purpose. The purpose of the world is to prevent us from realizing it has no purpose. And of course, believing that it has a purpose is incredibly stupid. And what we believe it, we believe that incredible stupidity is honoring, just showing how creative we are. So the ones who are even more stupid are like greater. That in itself is stupidity, because it's not true. So stupidity is this terrible, terrible path. We think that we can outsmart it by being even more stupid. Doesn't work. Now, if yesterday was brutal for me, today's even more brutal. Because I had the answer in my hands and I fumbled yesterday evening late and I fumbled it away. It's like you're on the 18th hole, it's final hole, and you say, okay, I finally got it down now. And you slice your drive out of bounds and you just say, are you kidding me? Another brutal hole. You know, how stupid is that? And so it's forgiveness. Forgiveness is the path about forgiving yourself for being so stupid, forgiving yourself for fumbling away the answers. Forgive yourself because you have a severe continuity problem. All right. Because you thought that if you were just completely stupid, you'd be greater than God. Because, of course, that's one thing God can't do, right? Is be completely stupid. In fact, we cannot be completely stupid. And this is the problem that we face, is that we cannot be completely stupid. It's impossible. We cannot be completely whimsical. It's impossible. And whimsicality, the purpose of whimsicality is the belief that we can be perfectly whimsical. The purpose of stupidity is to believe we can be perfectly stupid. We can't. We cannot. Now we can keep saying, well, I'm stupid about that. It doesn't change the fact at all. And that's what we've done. We've said, well, oh, I see that I can't be perfectly stupid. Oh, but I'm going to fumble that away and be stupid about it, and that means that I can be perfectly stupid. No, it doesn't. It doesn't mean that. It just means that we're continuing to believe in that we can be perfectly stupid, but we cannot be. We cannot be perfectly stupid, so you know, it's a failure. This attempt is a failure. The purpose of the world is to prevent us from realizing it has no purpose. The purpose of the Holy Spirit is to enable us to realize the world has no purpose, or that we cannot be without purpose, actually. We cannot be perfectly stupid. We cannot be without purpose. We cannot be other than how God created us to be, actually. We can pretend, but we can't be other than what God created us to be. So at the last second, I had the answer and I fumbled it away. Understandable, because I didn't expect to find it. I expected to fail. And so, to see that I could actually not fail was like a shock to my system. We expect to fail here. Everybody expects to fail. They expect to try and fail. Which just proves their superiority. Like, I'm more stupid than you. I'm more of a failure than you. I'm going, and then we use that relativeness to say I'm greater than you. Say, well, I'm continuing my failure longer than you are, so I'm a greater failure than you are, therefore I'm greater than you. Remember though, what we're trying to do is be perfectly stupid, perfect failure. And if we don't attain to perfect failurehood, then the whole effort's a failure, actually. It's much ado about nothing, waste of time. So basically what we're really saying is, well, I fumbled truth away longer than you did. What's the prize? Nothing. There's no prize for that. And this is what we have to realize, that there's no prize for our stupidity at all. None. Because the whole purpose was to attain to perfect stupidity. And if we don't achieve that, then it's just been a waste of time. Just a waste of time. It's been a waste of time. All of this world is a waste of time. The whole world's a waste of time. Everything we've done is simply a waste of time. Everything we've done in regard to this world and our efforts to be perfectly stupid is a waste. Is it been a waste of time? So wasting more time doesn't change that at all. It's just wasting more time. And so you have to face your stupidity at some point and realize this strategy of stupidity doesn't work. But even so, we have a severe continuity problem, and it caused me to fumble away the answer. I had the answer. I had it. I had the handle on salvation. I had it. It's right there in my hands. Fumbled it away. Instead, I wasted my time in something, you know, completely meaningless. Not only did I fumble it away, but I can't afford to fumble it away. See, that compounds things. It's easy to fumble it away when you say, well, it's no big deal. But when it really, you really need to get it and you still fumble it away, then that's incredibly bad. Now, maybe I just slice my ball into a severe hazard. Okay, that's fine. Maybe I can find my ball in the hazard. Maybe I can play out of the hazard. That's what I have to do. I have to believe that's possible. So I have to go find my ball. Maybe it's in the weeds and blocked by trees and everything. I'm going to have to try to hit a, you know, a tremendous shot and just trust in the Holy Spirit. And I'm going to have to ask the Holy Spirit for help. Of course, feel foolish and say, the Holy Spirit, just help me, and I fumble the answer away. I just fumble it away, so I feel stupid asking for more help. But that's the continuity problem. When you accept I have a severe continuity problem, it's the only problem I have. Only the vision of oneness cures that continuity problem. Okay, I need a handle on the vision of oneness, Holy Spirit. And when we get the Holy Spirit's help, we're so shocked. We're shocked. I didn't expect it. Wow, I didn't expect such, you know, the total success. I didn't expect it. Even though I've been aiming at it, you still have some doubts. Here, the fact is, we will never give truth the benefit of the doubt in this world because of our continuity problem. We'll never give it the benefit of the doubt. Never. We're always going to give the world the benefit of the doubt here because familiarity, continuity problem. So we're going to fumble the answers away when they come to us. We're going to not give them the benefit of the doubt, which then makes us feel very forlorn, you know, and it's just brutal. I said, why? If I just gave it the benefit of the doubt, I'd be free by now. I'd be saved, I'd be free. But I didn't give it the benefit of the doubt. We give stupidity the benefit of the doubt. So, my ball's somewhere in a hazard right now instead of right on the fairway. Perfect position. Which means more difficult, more difficulty. But that's how the path goes. Is when you're making great progress, you're going to eventually run it, fumble the ball away, eventually. Because it's so unfamiliar, you're going to such unfamiliar territory, such unexpected, you know, wow, I've got it. And then you're going to say, I didn't expect that. I'm going to fumble it away. That's the price you pay. It's the path extracts a severe price, actually, of disappointment in yourself. Because you said, I just fumbled away my success. And so that is so tough, you know, to face that. Most people don't want to experience that, so they just try to learn. Like in school, grade school, you want to please the teacher. So you say, teacher, what do I need to do to please you? And okay, and you get A's on the test, and you do everything. Teacher's pet, you do everything right. You know, the teacher's pet. He says, this is the way. But they want to avoid that disappointment. But on the true spiritual path is a path of disappointment. You're going to run into severe disappointment in yourself. Because you're going to see yourself fumble away the answers that you really need and that are needed. And instead, you're going to try and figure out what you think the teacher wants and how to please the teacher, how to please something, instead of actually getting the answer. And so you end up having to face your own stupidity and your ineptness and your continuity fear. So it's a path of great disappointments. And most people, you know, don't want to do that yet. They say, no. I want to be happy. Good luck in being happy in this with this world. You're going to end up trying to control others to be in the service of your so-called happiness. And how happy is that? How happy was Howard Hughes, you know? you're going to end up being like Howard Hughes. In control of so much, but never enough. And, you know, freaking out, developing obsessions, compulsions. You don't even realize you go into obsessions and compulsions. The world is obsessive compulsive, actually. And you don't even realize you're in it until it gets to be just, you know, you think, if I just double down one more time, it's going to work. I'm going to be able to control everything. I'm going to be happy, therefore. I'm going to make everything stable for me. And it's just... So, the path is a path of severe disappointments. You say, oh, you realize I decided to side with stupidity once again, even though I knew it was wrong. I decided to do it again, even though I can't afford to do so. I still decided to do it again. It's like a death wish, you know. You're siding with death, actually. It's extremely embarrassing, humiliating. So, you know, it's the path of one requires great humility. It teaches you great humility, and most not yet ready for that. They want to appear to be very competent and happy, well adjusted to this world, well adjusted, well adjusted to death. So what we do here is we give permission to feel that, the feeling, the disappointment, the humiliation, and the need for a little time to put up with that bitter taste, very bitter taste. It's not happy, happy. Most of the time it's like, wow, how could I be so stupid? And we say, well, the continuity problem, we have an answer for that. Severe continuity problem. I have a very severe continuity problem. No question about it. So I'm waiting for this answer for me to refocus on it. It's there. I just didn't keep my focus on it. That's all. I didn't keep my attention focused on it. That's all that happened. It's the answer's right there. It's always been there. Kind of like what you've been looking for your whole life. Finally you see it, and then you turn your eyes over someplace else. What's that over there? What is that? And then, where'd it go? And of course, having done that a million times, you think that you'd learn. You don't, because the continuity problem is still there. So I'm saying that accepting that you have the severe continuity problem is the saving grace of this world. Because then at least you do have a handle on the situation. You've got a position that you can maintain. It's a forgiven position. You're forgiving yourself. That then enables your attention to get refocused. Afraid to say, wow, what if it comes with that answer, I see it again, and I fumble away again, you see, that's just, I can't handle that. Well, you're going to have to handle that. Now, the last hole, like the 18th hole, the whole purpose is just to finish the hole. It's not how you finish, it's finishing it. So, even if you're hacking it through the weeds, you just got to hack it through the weeds. The ego, our continuity fear tells us we got to finish it great, otherwise it's going to be a disaster. That's not true. It's only finishing it that's important. That's it. Not how you finish. Not how you finish, it's only that you finish. You don't have to look good finishing. That's what prevents the finishing, right? Slice your drive out. I'm never gonna get this, but it's only finishing. Finishing is getting it. What we're really saying is I'm never not going to get this. As we get to the 18th hole, we're realizing, I'm never going to get this. I'm never not going to get this. I'm never going to be totally stupid. all of this was a waste of time. All the previous holes is all a waste of time. And then you tend to think, wow, I don't know if I can handle seeing that. I don't know if I can handle seeing the handle to get free. I don't know if I can handle seeing that. That it was all completely unnecessary, useless, futile. Purpose of the world is to prevent us from seeing it has no purpose. So, I guess of course you're gonna slice the ball out of bounds under those circumstances. That's par for this hole. Who's setting par for the 18th hole, you know? Do we know what par is on the final hole? We assume it's four. Maybe five, four. Well, maybe it's not. Maybe the par on the final hole is like a 12. Right? We all know what par is on the final. So, you know, keep playing it. Keep playing the final hole. Maybe you'll shoot par after all. Put your faith in the Holy Spirit for sure. The Holy Spirit will have some answer for you that will make you chuckle. Like assuming, we just assumed that there was a par four. Maybe it's not. Maybe the hazards are so severe, difficult on this hole, it's a par 12. Maybe it's expected it'll take you like three drives, penalty drive, you know, out of bounds, penalty shot, out of bounds, penalty shot, out of bounds. Finally you get one in the fairway. That's expected. Maybe on the final hole that's expected. Because we're not used to the layout of the 18th hole, because the layout of the 18th hole is actually the clubhouse. You see the clubhouse there. That's part of the layout. See, the other holes you don't see that. Maybe on the ninth hole you might, but maybe they may not route it that way. So you're seeing the finish. You're seeing home. That's part of the layout. So of course that's going to distract you. You know, it's going to have an effect because you say, whoa, this is the final hole. This is it. I'm finished. And part of you is going to say, oh, I don't want to quite finish it. I want to keep playing. So you hit the ball out of bounds. You can hit it all over the place. So you can keep playing more shots, more shots, more shots. And you may botch every shot on the hole. And you might miss a 2-foot putt, too. So you have to get to the point where it's just a tap-in. Because that's it. So maybe I had a tap-in left, you know, a 2-foot tap-in, I miss it. And I'm just like, wow. So the final shot is a missed shot like that, a missed 2-footer. Maybe you can't make the last shot at all. You have to take a gimme. It's given to you. It's a gimme. Why? Because there's no hole on the 18th green. You're assuming there's a hole, so you think you see it. And you hit your putt there, it doesn't go in the hole. And you hit it again, it still doesn't go in. You say, wow, I can't. The fact is, there isn't any hole there. We're just assuming so much that it is. We see something we think is irregular, more or less. Oh, that's less. That must be it. I'm just not seeing it well, but it must be it. So we believe, like, it's there, must be there. The ball doesn't drop. So you pick the ball up, and someone says, the Holy Spirit says, that's a gimme. Final green is a gimme, actually. That's the handle. It's a gimme. It's a gift. The vision of oneness is a gift. It's a gimme. That is the handle. Now you can put this in any sort of symbology you want to. I'm just using something I'm familiar with. It still holds water. This is a profound insight, but I'm just showing that it is possible to, you know, just remain calm. Take the edge off, the impact off, the shock of it off a little bit like this. Absolutely brings tears to my eyes a little bit, but it's such a relief, tremendous relief. The handle is like realizing that there isn't any handle on this world. You don't need to find a handle on this world. So, again, the path works. Because it's sitting quietly enables you to go through the shock of these realizations and just the commitment, the ability to say, I know I can just sit here quietly for a long time, that enables these really big shocks to occur. Because you say, well, I may need quite some time to get used to this. Well, you know you can do it. Just to say, pick it up, you're done. There isn't any hole there. In other words, there's nothing to accomplish, actually, in this world. There isn't any way to finish, except to pick it up. Pick up your ball, you're done. There isn't any way to finish. There isn't any way to win the game. You see, if you don't complete the 18th hole, how can you post a score? How can you finish the round? You can't finish the round. Holy Spirit says, pick up your ball. You're done. That's good. Can you post a score? No. Because there isn't any hole on the 18th green. You can't post a score. So nobody has a score. Everyone would think they're thinking they're working on their score. Scoring well, not this one, not so good. My technique, how I adjust, I gotta post a great score. I'm gonna post a great score. But now you know, looking back, you realize none of them will post a score. No one will ever post a score here. Now each hole is like a lifetime, so to speak. Or you can play many holes in one lifetime, you know, if you're really on the spiritual path. What dies is death, actually. What dies here is death. You cannot post a score. So you get in the clubhouse and you think, wow, you know, I'm going to be around all these great golfers that shot some incredibly low score. I just like botched the 18th. I shot a super high score, but you realize nobody finished the 18th hole. Nobody posted a score. All of those in the clubhouse, they didn't post a score either. So you're among equals, are you not? You know, you don't see Jesus, and Jesus said, hey, I buried the last hole. How did you do? No. Jesus said, hey, there is no, I didn't post any score at all. There's no way to post a score. Thank you. we assume that those who have so-called, you know, those who are enlightened or whatever, awakened or you want to call it, say, wow, they probably shot a super low score. Unbelievable. How'd they do that? I got to learn how to do that. They didn't post any score. That's the secret. Everyone wants to know what the secret is. That is the secret. That is the handle. Nobody finished. There's no way to finish the course. There's no way to finish it. So you say, well, I'm done then. In other words, there's no way to succeed in stupidity. Don't struggle with the words. That just can, when you start struggling, you know that you're in words again. How do I explain it to people? You know, how, people say, how did you succeed? Wow, this is incredible. You're in ecstasy. How did you, what's your secret? Secret, you know, all of this stuff. Yeah. So, so disturbances are coming in the world. big disturbances. But this realization, disturbances don't bother it. It's more profound in the world. It is more profound. We get to the 18th green, and we finally realize there's nothing to learn. There's nothing to learn. There is no hole there. In other words, there's nothing to achieve. There's nothing to learn. Wait, just a waste of time. The whole thing was just a waste of time. You're trying to learn how to adjust to light not being light. Light is light. So that you really can't adjust to it. It's not there. How can we adjust to what isn't there to adjust to? It only seems like it's there. We're hallucinating. We're thinking, well, light is pretending that it's not light, but it is light. So we can never adjust to light not being light, because light always will be light. So, the world is always taking out the garbage. Someone is always being scapegoated and labeled as garbage, blamed for the failure, blamed for the difficulty of adjusting to the light that isn't light. They say, it's so difficult. I have such a great difficulty. Never seem to get it right. So it's always someone's being blamed, always the garbage being taken out, always something's being thrown away, discarded, constant process of discarding, 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 constantly generating new scapegoats, new blame. What can we do here except generate scapegoats, generate blame? Got to bring blame into the world, right? In order to blame it. Light is blaming itself. I'm not the light, you are. And then light says, no, I'm not the light, you are. I'm not the light, you are. How come we can't get to no light here? What's going on? Who's to blame for this? So that the blame game is always being played in this scenario here, always being played. Is it fair? No, it's never fair. It's never true. It's never true. But we have to get an overview of what's going on instead of being pulled into, you know, who's being blamed, why, and all this. Get past that. So, as this blame game continues to play out, all it is this world's a blame game. Zero sum, completely useless, waste. If you're playing a blame game, what you're doing is you're thinking, I still can succeed at this. It's just there's something that is causing me to not succeed, instead of saying it's impossible. When you realize it's impossible, I cannot adjust to what doesn't exist. And light not being light doesn't exist. It's pretending to exist, but all it is a pretense. So a pretense that it doesn't really exist. We're pretending it exists. So we're trying to adjust to something that we're pretending exists, except it doesn't. So it never feels real to us. It never feels real. And so we blame someone for, you're the reason why it doesn't feel real. So this whole world is just this constant blame game. So as this blame game continues, and it most certainly is very harsh now, but it has been throughout history, hasn't it? It's always this blame is going on somewhere. So they always. And the more people shout peace, 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 peace in the world, the more severe the blame game is taking place. What they're doing is building up the resolve to say, I will be peaceful as soon as I get rid of, you know, that. As soon as the garbage is taken out. I'm ready to be peaceful. That's the world saying, we're really ready to be peaceful. Therefore, we're totally behind the effort to get rid of the garbage. That's what the world is saying. So it's super primed for a blame situation. There are false flags that are coming. Well, I've been warned about those very severely. It has to do with water and... So there are severe false flags are coming. The blame game is going to shift into overdrive here. The key is to be able to be unmoved by this, undisturbed by that, so that the garbage truck's roaring didn't disturb me at all. There's nothing to disturb. There's no success to disturb. Cannot succeed, cannot post a score. There's no score to post here. It's zero. What was my score? Zero. I shot zero, actually. Somebody asked you, hey, you finished your round? I said, well, not exactly. I didn't finish the round. Well, what happened? Well, I shot a zero. What are you talking about? Yeah, I shot a zero. I ended up shooting a zero. Quietness, stillness, is simply adjusting, getting familiar with the shock of these kind of statements. I've never ever heard anyone say, I shot a zero. This is the light that's talking to me, is it shot a zero. Just a way of dealing with the continuity fear. Zero times zero. What did you shoot? I shot a zero. That just stops the mind, doesn't it? It just stops everything. Just being taken out. Focusing on a shot of zero is so profound that all this garbage stuff doesn't, you know, impact, doesn't really. It's not even annoying. So a zero a good score, or a zero a bad score? Or maybe it's no score. What's important is don't struggle with words. Don't struggle with words. So oftentimes words can be used to just put you back into that realization. Don't worry what kind of words are being used or how they're being used. As long as it has that effect, that's fine. Because familiarity with this feeling is what's important. Not with the words. Familiarity with the feeling. If you can call it a feeling, it's really a true feeling as opposed to all this fake feeling we've been engaging with. You can call it anything you want. You can call it zero. You can call it ecstasy. You can call it bliss. You can call it zero. You can call it whatever you want. Doesn't matter. Don't struggle with any words. We're trying to make that last putt on the 18th green. The ball won't go in the hole. And so we're obsessing about the putter grips. What's wrong with my grip? What's wrong with my alignment? I'm not reading it right. I'm what's wrong with me? It must be something in the grip and I just can't hit it straight. I can't hit it where I want to. It just keeps missing the hole. And then you hear pick the ball up. There isn't any hole there. There isn't any hole. And then you realize all your obsessions and compulsions with your grip and your alignment and your reading the putt and your judgment and everything, none of that was true. None of it's needed because there isn't any hole. There isn't any finish. So all the attempts to figure out a way to finish don't need any. Realizing that we don't need to make any adjustments is the finish. Realizing we don't need to know anything is the finish. We don't need to know anything. Now, we don't have to obsess about not knowing anything either. We're so used to obsessing about adjustments. Let me try this grip. Let me just adjust the angle a little bit, adjusting angles and everything. We realize there is no hole there. So there's no need for any adjustments at all. Just pick your ball up, you're done. So we may keep obsessing about that. Obsessing about I don't need to know anything. That's why it's important, don't struggle with words, because that leads to obsession, leads to compulsion, leads to all this thinking, which is just adjustments. So you even let go of, I don't need to know anything. Let go of that too. Don't need that either. You could say, I'm done trying to be done. trying to post a score. No more. I'm not going to try again to post a score. Cannot post a score. Perfect freedom cannot post a score. Perfect freedom cannot be finished. Perfect freedom cannot be done. There's nothing to be done in reality. There's nothing to be finished in reality. You see, the body is a symbol of finishing, is it not? This world is a whole symbol of finishing. The body dies, you're finished, you're finished. The body's finished, you're done. We're not bodies. I'm not a body, I am free, I am as God created me. You can't finish. So we're done trying to be done. So you can use language that way. The feeling, you can feel it. You realize that the relief is there. The ecstasy of non-ecstasy. But we insist that words make sense. We insist that the language makes sense. We insist on understanding language. But language is adjustments, or adjustments. Language cannot be actually understood, but it can be used to highlight that it can't be understood. So I'm done with being done. You know, that like brings you right back to zero, doesn't it? So the best way to use language is to bring us right back to zero, and then set zero down as well. The ecstasy of non-ecstasy, you see? That's on the level of language and words and concepts and thinking. So at that level, all you can do is zero. Zero times zero, actually, zero times zero, because we don't want to just rest at zero, because zero will set zero down, because zero, the zero is zero, the axis. Because language can say, I can finish. This word symbolizes finishing. It's arbitrary, completely whimsical. So the finish of non-finishing. been said, there's nobody here. There's nobody here. There's no finisher here. There's no doer because there's no done here. What is doing except to be done? What is doing except to be done? I'm finished. Done. There's no finishing in reality. There's no doing. There's no done. We're done. We can't even be done with being done. There isn't any finish. So we can't even be finished with no finish. Thinking keeps trying to find a finish. Now, if you know this, there is no hole on the 18th green. In fact, there's never been any holes. But let's just keep it easy. There's no hole on the 18th green. Can't finish. So there's all these people who are getting ready to play their round. They're out on the putting, practice putting greens, and they're practicing their putting, and they're saying, wow, I know there's going to be a really tough putt to make out there. I'm really going to have to dial in my putting. Now, are you going to, like, spend your time watching those people on the putting green, knowing that how it ends, that they can't make the putt on the 18th green? Nobody ever does, because there's no hole there. So all this effort, you know, trying to fine-tune their putting stroke, waste of time. So that's why we say that you're not interested in the world. You're no longer interested in the world. That's all the world's doing, is people are really practicing, and you can say they're playing, but they're really trying to fine-tune their abilities to finish. There is no ability to finish. People say, well, ecstasy, that'll interfere with my ability to finish. You seem like you don't care. You know, you seem like not even practicing, not even focused on it. How's that helping me? I gotta get really focused. I really got to get my abilities, you know, super fine-tuned here. And of course, these are quibbles brought up by the continuity problem. So, when do you feel it being pulled down, your mind is being pulled down into struggling, identify it that it's continuity problem, fears of the continuity. Let's bring these quibbles up and say, okay, I'm not going to, don't struggle with it. Of course, it feels like I got to go faster right now. So it feels like struggling with it makes you go faster. It actually makes you go slower. So we're trying to keep language from collapsing in on itself, actually. Symbols from collapsing in on themselves, like finish of no finish. Because when symbols collapse like this, and this is what they talk about, the shattering of the mind, the collapsing of language, of symbols, of words, of concepts. Well, it's not really a collapse or a shattering. It's like a very gentle subsidence, so to speak, where language goes into this form of not finishing. The finish of not finishing. So what I'm getting familiar with, and I'm barely or even aware of it, but it seems the mind is very still and quiet. I'm not really aware of that much, but if I pay attention, it just seems like there's a little tune there. The jukebox is playing, still playing in the background somewhere. But that's about it. But that's not really, you know, some goal that I'm striving for. I'm you know, just sort of the countryside that I'm driving into. I'm just driving, and I guess you drive away from the city and you get in the countryside and you just say, hey, eventually, at some point, you're out there camping or somewhere, and it dawns on you, hey, wait, it's quiet here, it's very still. I mean, I didn't recognize it at first, actually. There's so much noise in the city, airplanes and cars and just motorcycles and muscle, and powering up a muscle car somewhere. You get out in the countryside and it's just totally still, totally quiet, and you say, what's that? What's the sound? What's that sound I'm hearing? Sound of stillness. But this kind of just, you just say, oh, you just notice it at some point, but the focus is not there. The focus is, to get familiar with whatever it is that is present now. So as long as there's focus, it seems like there's activity and noise. As long as there's effort, it feels that there's activity and noise. So you don't really know exactly what you're getting used to, because there's still effort and noise there. Handle is that there isn't any handle. The finish is that there isn't any finish. Isn't this entire world a world of appearing to finish, constant finishes? Everything starts and finishes, starts and finishes, starts and finishes. Nothing can start and nothing can finish. You might say God is that which never started. We're trying to find a beginning to God. God is the beginningless, both the endless and the beginningless. It's all endless because it has no beginning. How can something end if it doesn't have a beginning? And again, all language is the purpose here is to bring us back to this sort of shock of realization. Realization is actually a shock. And what we're doing is we're gradually getting used to the shock a bit at a time, bit at a time, bit at a time, bit at a time. It's such so shocking, the great news is so shocking that we have to do it a bit at a time. We have to keep proving that we can finish. We've got to prove that I can finish. Well, that's trying to be greater than God, to say that there's a start. Therefore, if there's a start, you can say there's a finish. But reality is endlessness, has no beginning and no end. Reality has no beginning, actually. Truth has no beginning. It has no end. So most certainly, when you're with somebody who's sharing the light of truth, and you're doing it too. I mean, right? When you're in a situation where that's happening, the teacher-student dichotomy is a little bit off. There's a situation where that's happening, where the light of truth is being shared, being focused on, then the what's happening is the shock of realization is happening. So it's about managing that shock of realization in the words. Are just you just being used to turn you back to that and say, stay with it, stay with it, stay with it. And being reminded that that's the fast track. Struggling with explanations is the slow track, it slows you down. So don't struggle with words. If you cannot use words in an easy, right way, don't struggle with them. People are struggling with the feeling. They say, I need to find that beginning to this so I can find an end to it. Ecstasy is just the feel, is the realization there's no beginning and there's no end. There's no beginning. So I don't have to find a beginning. I don't have to keep searching for a beginning. Is the desire for a beginning. A word, a symbol.